With Muammar Gaddafi assassinated by his captors, NATO has declared its operation in Libya a success. But what was the justification for NATO's intervention in the first place? This is the Global Research Backgrounder on grtv.ca. Welcome. This is James Corbett of the Corbett Report for Global Research TV at grtv.ca. The killing of Muammar Gaddafi at the hands of NATO-backed, Al-Qaeda-linked forces marks the end of a campaign expressly aimed at the assassination of a head of state and overthrow of a sovereign country, in direct violation of international standards that have held sway since the Nuremberg trials at the end of World War II and the establishment of the Geneva Conventions. The NATO campaign, known as Operation Unified Protector, was a continuation of the US-led Operation Odyssey Dawn. It formally began on March 23, 2011, and was ostensibly an operation to enforce United Nations Security Council Resolution 1973. From the outset, the NATO coalition partners insisted that the aim of the mission was not to assist a rebel insurgency in overthrowing the Gaddafi government, but to protect civilians in accordance with UN resolutions.
But broadening our military mission to include regime change would be a mistake. The task that I assigned our forces to protect the Libyan people from immediate danger and to establish a no-fly zone carries with it a UN mandate and international support. It's also what the Libyan opposition asked us to do. If we tried to overthrow Gaddafi by force, our coalition would splinter.
The real intention of the operation was revealed shortly thereafter, however, in a joint op-ed in the pages of the International Herald Tribune penned by Obama, Cameron, and Sarkozy. Our duty and our mandate under UN Security Council Resolution 1973 is to protect civilians, and we are doing that. It is not to remove Gaddafi by force, they wrote in their editorial. But it is impossible to imagine a future for Libya with Gaddafi in power. It is unthinkable that someone who has tried to massacre his own people can play a part in their future government. Within a month, the true aim of the intervention to assassinate Gaddafi was confirmed when NATO forces bombed the personal residence of Saif al-Arab Gaddafi, Muammar's youngest son, in an admitted attempt to kill the Libyan leader himself. While Gaddafi himself was not caught in the strike, his son and three of his grandchildren were killed in the bombing. Now it is confirmed that the strike that resulted in the death of Gaddafi was initiated, organized, coordinated, and led by NATO and SAS forces. The attack began when Gaddafi was fleeing Sirte in a convoy of 75 vehicles. Drone pilots at Creech Air Force Base in Nevada launched a round of Hellfire missiles from a Predator drone aircraft, destroying the lead vehicle and prompting a French bomber to release two laser-guided 500-pound bombs into the center of the convoy. British SAS troops, meanwhile, coordinated the ground forces that eventually captured Gaddafi. The news of Gaddafi's death was greeted with elation by NATO leaders around the world and echoed by pundits and talking heads of every political persuasion.
It cost us $1 trillion to get Saddam and $1 billion to get Gaddafi.
Well, Libya says they're going to pay back the billion that we spent, too. So it's going to end up being sort of free for nothing.
So let's get in on the ground. There's a lot of money to be made in the future in Libya. There's a lot of oil to be produced.
Boy, I tell you, these Arab dictators, they're not very original. Just like Saddam Hussein, caught him in a hole.
Muammar Gaddafi was a bad guy.
The ostensible justification for the entire campaign, however, the charge that Gaddafi was engaged in a massacre of his own people, has since been shown to be based on falsehoods, misrepresentations, and undocumented allegations. The process that launched the intervention was begun by a coalition of 70 non-governmental organizations, which issued a joint letter urging the UN to suspend Libya from the Human Rights Council and for the Security Council to invoke the so-called responsibility to protect principle in protecting the Libyan people from alleged atrocities being committed by the Libyan government. In a special session on the issue on February 25th, the UN Human Rights Council adopted a resolution affirming the NGO's recommendations. The resolution was adopted without a vote. The Security Council immediately passed resolutions 1970 and 1973, authorizing the establishment of a no-fly zone on Libyan military aviation for the protection of civilians and the delivery of humanitarian assistance in Libya. 3 days later, using the resolution as its justification, the US, UK, and France began bombing the population of Libya. Meanwhile, the International Criminal Court's chief prosecutor, Luis Moreno Ocampo, began working on the legal basis for the invasion. He drafted the request for the court's judges to issue an arrest warrant for Gaddafi for crimes against humanity. Although NATO forces were already engaged in an invasion of the country on the basis of undocumented allegations by a group of NGOs, Moreno Ocampo's request was not issued until May 16th. On June 28th, the day after the judges agreed to issue the warrant, Moreno Ocampo participated in a press conference in which one reporter asked about the evidence that Gaddafi had ever engaged in the atrocities he was accused of.
My question is, could you give me some example of your you offered to the international crime courts? How many people have been killed, and in which town, in which site, and what kind of the crimes he has ever done in your investigation? So we always know the facts always can make the people convinced. So thank you so much.
I advise you to read the application of the prosecutor office, many pages, I think it was 77 pages. We describe in detail the facts. Most of it is public. And the judges also decided, analyzing the evidence. So, of course, we are prosecutors and judges, so we rely on facts. So we prove the crimes. That's what we did.
Although the document that Moreno Ocampo urges the public to read to understand the evidence of Gaddafi's crimes is indeed public and is 77 pages long, the version available to the public has been heavily redacted. In fact, of the 77 pages, 53 of them have been redacted, comprising the entire section of the document dealing with the evidence for the charges themselves. As French analyst Thierry Masson points out in a recent article for the Voltaire Network republished on Global Research, this is not the first time Gaddafi has been vilified on the international stage, only to be exonerated later. As Masson notes, a German trial which pinned the 1986 bombing of a discotheque in Berlin on Gaddafi and led to a U.S. strike on his palace that resulted in the death of his daughter and 49 other civilians later turned out to have been a false conviction set up by a CIA agent, and the bomber himself turned out to be a Mossad agent. In the case of the 1988 Lockerbie bombing, the chief Scottish investigator later admitted that the main piece of evidence in the case, the bomb timer, had actually been planted at the scene by a CIA agent. The expert who examined the timer admitted to manufacturing it himself, and the star witness who connected the bomb to the suitcase later admitted having received $2 million to lie on the stand. Now, as Michelle Chosadowski of the Center for Research on Globalization has pointed out, the NATO forces that have been bombing Libya relentlessly for the last 7 months in the name of protecting the civilian population there are going to extract Libya's wealth as the spoils of war by urging the new Libyan government to pay for the reconstruction of the country's shattered infrastructure through debt issued at the Libyan people's expense, owed to the very NATO powers who destroyed that infrastructure in the first place.
And Mr. Chosadowski, do you believe that NATO and the U.S. will now bring in their engineering firms such as Halliburton, Baker Hughes, and security firms such as DynaCorp and Blackwater to rebuild the country as they did with Iraq?
Well, what I think the scenario is to rebuild this country on borrowed money. In other words, what we're going to have are the donors and creditors will come in and say, we will lend you money, but in fact, all the money, all the financial assets of Libya have been confiscated. Libya wouldn't have needed anybody to come and rebuild. But the irony is that you go into a country, you bomb its infrastructure. I mean, we're talking about water, food distribution, roads, transportation, health, educational facilities, government buildings, 10,000 strike sorties, and then you come. It's a very cynical statement. We come in and we will rebuild what we have destroyed. We will reconstruct what we have destroyed. And that destruction was the direct result of United Nations Security Council 1973, or at least its interpretation, which then gave NATO the green light to go and bomb the country. And it will be done with borrowed money. And of course, the security firms, the mercenary companies, the big construction firms will come in. And, of course, part of this agenda is ultimately the privatization of Libya's oil reserves, which constitute approximately 3.5% of global oil reserves.
The tragedy of the situation is revealed in a 2009 World Health Organization report, which noted that Libya under Gaddafi had enjoyed some of the highest living standards in Africa. As the report noted, in 2009, Libyans enjoyed a life expectancy of over 72 years, a decline in child mortality from 70 per thousand live births to as low as 19 per thousand, universal access for primary education, and the highest literacy and educational enrollment rates in North Africa. Now, as Libya lies shattered and as old tribal tensions and rivalries seem destined to once again plunge Libya into strife and internal warring, the NATO-backed UN-sanctioned National Transitional Council is claiming that they will investigate their own alleged slaughter of pro-Gaddafi forces in Sirte, where Human Rights Watch is noting that as many as 53 Gaddafi supporters were executed in cold blood at the Mahari Hotel in recent weeks, their hands tied behind their backs as they were shot with AK-47s and FN-1s. This even as U.S. Secretary of State Hillary Clinton calls for an investigation into the death of Gaddafi, a brutal assassination of a prisoner of war in direct contradiction to the Geneva Conventions, in which her own forces played a key role. Although Gaddafi's family is said to be willing to take the death of Colonel Gaddafi to The Hague, it is a foregone conclusion that the gears of international justice that were so quick to turn in the face of unsupported, undocumented assertions of Gaddafi's war crimes will be ground to a halt in the face of this open-and-shut case of documented, verifiable war crimes. And it is beyond certain that, absent some fundamental change in international political relations, the court will never try the architects of this war, a brutal campaign of bombing against the very population that they were allegedly protecting, for their own part in international war crimes. For more on this story and other breaking news and current events, please go to globalresearch.ca. For more research and analysis by James Corbett, please go to corbettreport.com.